show dedicated to a special individual of New Jersey of the past, Mr. Paul Robeson, celebrating this past Black History Month.
That's the old man that I wants to be. What does he care if the world's not right? What does he care if the land ain't green? Oh, man, river, oh, man, river, he must know someday, but don't say nothing, he just he keeps on rolling. He don't plant taters, he don't plant cotton, and in my plants of is soon forgotten. But oh man river, he just keeps rolling along. You and me, we sweat and strain, body all aching and racked with pain. Tote that rod, that bale, get a little drunk and your land's in jail. Buck gets weary and sick of trying. I'm tired of living and scared.
That was a version, supposedly the best version of Old Man River by William Warfield. I guess that is the writer. I know that was Paul Robeson singing. At least I think it was. Was it? You know what? Let us put Paul Robeson singing in the background while we hear a little bit about the history behind this individual. Who is a native, born, raised, and unfortunately died, New Jersey, famous worldwide during his time, and a unique voice, an athlete, and was brought up as a topic in the last city council meeting that we had, the 25th, by Mr. Joey Novak and Ms. Fine. So let's listen to some of his music while we hear some of the history behind Mr. Robeson. All right, and you know I'm just gonna just go back and forth. His voice is very unique, and what I'll do is hold on just a moment. I got it. Okay, hold on. Here we go.
Paul Robeson was the epitome of the 20th century Renaissance man. He was an exceptional athlete, actor, singer, cultural scholar, author, and political activist. His talents made him a revered man of his time. Yet his radical political beliefs all but erased him from popular history. Today, more than 100 years after his birth, Robeson is just beginning to receive the credit he is due. Born in 1898, Paul Robeson grew up in Princeton, New Jersey. His father had escaped slavery and become a Presbyterian minister, while his mother was from a distinguished Philadelphia family. At 17, he was given a scholarship to Rutgers University, where he received an unprecedented 12 major letters in 4 years and was his class valedictorian. After graduating, he went on to Columbia University Law School and, in the early 1920s, took a job with a New York law firm. Racial strife at the firm ended Robeson's career as a lawyer early, but he was soon to find an appreciative home for his talents. Returning to his love of public speaking, Robeson began to find work as an actor. In the mid-1920s, he played the lead in Eugene O'Neill's All God's Children Got Wings, 1924, and The Emperor Jones, 1925. Throughout the late 1920s and 1930s, he was a widely acclaimed actor and singer. With songs such as his trademark, Old Man River, he became one of the most popular concert singers of his time. His Othello was the longest-running Shakespeare play in Broadway history, running for nearly 300 performances. It is still considered one of the great American Shakespeare productions. While his fame grew in the United States, he became equally well-loved internationally. He spoke 15 languages and performed benefits throughout the world for causes of social justice. More than any other performer of his time, he believed that the famous have a responsibility to fight for justice and peace. As an actor, Robeson was one of the first black men to play serious roles in the primarily white American theater. He performed in a number of films as well, including a remake of The Emperor Jones, 1933, and Song of Freedom, 1936. In a time of deeply entrenched racism, he continually struggled for further understanding of cultural difference. At the height of his popularity, Robeson was a national symbol and a cultural leader in the war against fascism abroad and racism at home. He was admired and befriended by both the general public and prominent personalities, including Eleanor Roosevelt, W.E.B. Du Bois, Joe Louis, Pablo Neruda, Lena Horne, and Harry Truman. While his varied talents and his outspoken defense of civil liberties brought him many admirers, it also made him enemies among conservatives trying to maintain the status quo. During the 1940s, Robeson's black nationalist and anti-colonialist activities brought him to the attention of Senator Joseph McCarthy. Despite his contributions as an entertainer to the Allied forces during World War II, Robeson was singled out as a major threat to American democracy. Every attempt was made to silence and discredit him, and in 1950 the persecution reached a climax when his passport was revoked. He could no longer travel abroad to perform, and his career was stifled. Of this time, Lloyd Brown, a writer and longtime colleague of Robeson, states, "Paul Robeson was the most persecuted, the most ostracized, the most condemned black man in America, then or ever." It was 8 years before his passport was reinstated. A weary and triumphant Robeson began again to travel and give concerts in England and Australia. But the years of hardship had taken their toll. After several bouts of depression, he was admitted to a hospital in London, where he was administered continued shock treatments. When Robeson returned to the United States in 1963, he was misdiagnosed several times and treated for a variety of physical and psychological problems. Realizing that he was no longer the powerful singer or agile orator of his prime, he decided to step out of the public eye. He retired to Philadelphia and lived in self-imposed seclusion until his death in 1976. To this day, Paul Robeson's many accomplishments remain obscured by the propaganda of those who tirelessly dogged him throughout his life. His role in the history of civil rights and as a spokesperson for the oppressed of other nations remains relatively unknown. In 1995, more than 75 years after graduating from Rutgers, his athletic achievements were finally recognized with his posthumous entry into the College Football Hall of Fame. Though a handful of movies and recordings are still available, they are a sad testament to one of the greatest Americans of the 20th century. If we are to remember Paul Robeson for anything, it should be for the courage and the dignity with which he struggled for his own personal voice and for the rights of all people.
Well, there you go. There goes one version of Mr. Robeson's past history in a nutshell. It was achieved at the www.pbs.org/WNET/American Masters/episodes/Paul Robeson or rather Paul-Robeson/about the actor, and just look it up at American Masters. There are videos on YouTube regarding this very talented person, multifaceted and very active, and unfortunately in the end of his life never rewarded. No good deed goes unpunished, as they say, right? But he did affect the American public and the world at the time that he lived, and despite what many people may think, he added to the flavor of justice, civil justice. So I'm just gonna let you guys hear one more version of Mr. Robeson's past, maybe covering a little bit more, and enjoy his music in the background. This one's called My Old Kentucky Home. Can you believe it, huh? Southern song, right? His voice is unique. I mean, I didn't know who this guy was. Well, I knew who this guy was from past seeing clips, history, and things like that, but I didn't remember his name until it was mentioned at the last town hall meeting. Well, anyway, let us give final tribute to Mr. Robeson in this, what just got finished as the Black History Month of February, and in honor of Mr. Robeson, and a native New Jerseyan, and from what I understand, a fellow Flemington resident of the long, long past. So here we go again with another version of his history, a brief biography.
Paul Robeson, a brief biography. Paul Robeson was a famous African-American athlete, singer, actor, and advocate for the civil rights of people around the world. He rose to prominence in a time when segregation was legal in the United States, and black people were being lynched by racist mobs, especially in the South. Born on April 9, 1898 in Princeton, New Jersey, Paul Robeson was the youngest of five children. His father was a runaway slave who went on to graduate from Lincoln University, and his mother came from an abolitionist Quaker family. Robeson's family knew both hardship and the determination to rise above it. His own life was no less challenging. In 1915, Paul Robeson won a four-year academic scholarship to Rutgers University. Despite violence and racism from teammates, he won 15 varsity letters in sports, baseball, basketball, track, and was twice named to the All-American football team. He received the Phi Beta Kappa Chi in his junior year, belonged to the Cap and Skull Honor Society, and graduated as valedictorian. However, it wasn't until 1995, 19 years after his death, that Paul Robeson was inducted into the College Football Hall of Fame. At Columbia Law School, 1919-1923, Robeson met and married Eslanda Cordiza Good, who was to become the first black woman to head a pathology laboratory. He took a job with a law firm, but left when the white secretary refused to take dictation from him. He left the practice of law to use his artistic talents in theater and music to promote African and African-American history and culture. In London, Robeson earned international acclaim for his lead role in Othello, for which he won the Donaldson Award for Best Acting Performance, 1944, and performed in Eugene O'Neill's Emperor Jones and All God's Children Got Wings. He is known for changing the lines of the showboat song, Old Man River, from the meek, I'm tired of living and feared of dying, to a declaration of resistance, I must keep fighting until I'm dying. His 11 films included Body and Soul, 1924, Jericho, 1937, and Proud Valley, 1939. Robeson's travels taught him that racism was not as virulent in Europe as in the US at home. It was difficult to find restaurants that would serve him. Theaters in New York would only seat blacks in the upper balconies, and his performances were often surrounded with threats or outright harassment. In London, on the other hand, Robeson's opening night performance of Emperor Jones brought the audience to its feet with cheers for 12 encores. Paul Robeson used his deep baritone voice to promote black spirituals, to share the cultures of other countries, and to benefit the labor and social movements of his time. He sang for peace and justice in 25 languages throughout the US, Europe, the Soviet Union, and Africa. Robeson became known as a citizen of the world, equally comfortable with the people of Moscow, Nairobi, and Harlem. Among his friends were future African leader Jomo Kenyatta, India's Nehru, historian Drive W.E.B. Du Bois, anarchist Emma Goldman, and writers James Joyce and Ernest Hemingway. In 1933, Robeson donated the proceeds of All God's Children to Jewish refugees fleeing Hitler's Germany. At a 1937 rally for the anti-fascist forces in the Spanish Civil War, he declared, "The artist must elect to fight for freedom or for slavery. I have made my choice. I had no alternative." In New York in 1939, he premiered in Earl Robinson's Ballad for Americans, a cantata celebrating multiracial face of America. It was greeted with the largest audience response since Orson Welles' famous War of the Worlds. During the 1940s, Robeson continued to perform and to speak out against racism, in support of labor, and for peace. He was a champion of working people and organized labor. He spoke and performed at strike rallies, conferences, and labor festivals worldwide. As a passionate believer in international, Robeson protested the growing Cold War and worked tirelessly for friendship and respect between the US and the USSR. In 1945, he headed an organization that challenged President Truman to support an anti-lynching law. In the late 1940s, when dissent was scarcely tolerated in the US, Robeson openly questioned why African Americans should fight in the army of a government that tolerated racism. Because of his outspokenness, he was accused by the House Un-American Activities Committee, HUAC, of being a communist. Robeson saw this as an attack on the democratic rights of everyone who worked for international friendship and for equality. The accusation nearly ended his career. 80 of his concerts were canceled, and in 1949 two interracial outdoor concerts in Peekskill, NY were attacked by racist mobs while state police stood by. Robeson responded, "I'm going to sing wherever the people want me to sing, and I won't be frightened by crosses burning in Peekskill or anywhere else." In 1950, the US revoked Robeson's passport, leading to an 8-year battle to resecure it and to travel again. During those years, Robeson studied Chinese, met with Albert Einstein to discuss the prospects for world peace, published his autobiography, Here I Stand, and sang at Carnegie Hall. During this time, in 1952 and 1953, he held two concerts at Peace Arch Park on the US-Canadian border, singing to 30,000-40,000 people in both countries. In 1957, he made a transatlantic radiophone broadcast from New York to coal miners in Wales. In 1960, Robeson made his last concert tour to New Zealand and Australia. In ill health, Paul Robeson retired from public life in 1963. He died on January 23, 1976, at age 77, in Philadelphia.
Okay, well, there you go. As a added dedication to Mr. Robeson for his many accomplishments, for his life. I'm sure that some of his families are still alive. grandsons, grandchildren, maybe sister, whatever. He did pass away in 1976, and in honor of Mr. Robeson, I dedicate this video. And we'll listen to the last part of this song and end the podcast show. So enjoy Mr. Robeson's talent.
But it leaves a thought that is beautiful.